Chapter 21. Obama Cared. Dr. Rosedale pushed open the big glass door to Pain Relief Associates, Inc., wheeling in his case full of completed paperwork, and stood at the front desk. Facing him from the other side of the ornate marble counter stood the front office supervisor, Candace Swenson. Standing almost as tall as him in her heels, she looked into his eyes and smiled warmly. Ever since his divorce, the female staff had been extra nice. "Morning, Candy," he said, his professional smile hiding the suspicion that she might want to become the next Mrs. Rosedale.
"You're in room 3, doctor,"
she said.
"I have you all set up."
She stood close, tilted her head towards him, and flashed a gorgeous smile.
"Come with me."
A slender hand with long red fingernails beckoned him to follow. Something on the waiting room television caught his ear. It was September 2010, and President Obama was announcing that he had just signed the Affordable Care Act, ACA, and now 50 million uninsured Americans would have access to health care insurance. "Candy, did you hear that?" he said, turning to watch her pivot and stride down the hall, high heels clicking and dress swishing as she left behind a sensuous aroma of musky perfume. He caught up with her. "Did you know that many people are uninsured?"
"Thank God for our president,"
she said.
"Half my family's uninsured, so now we can all get covered."
She took the opportunity to get more personal.
"By the way, how have you been, doctor? It's good to see you."
Arriving at room 3, she straightened up the already neatly arranged charts on his desk and waited for his next move. Her bright eyes cheerfully attended to him and lit his mind with the fantasy of kissing her, leaning over on the desk or using the exam table for a passionate makeout session. He started to ask her for a date. "Don't get your honey where you make your money," an inner voice warned. Still, she was hard to resist. Gracious, glamorous, and talented, the soulmate days were over, but an evening out on the town together might be nice. "I'm doing all right, everything considered. Thank you for asking." He knew that she knew about his divorce with Erenka. The thought that she might date him if asked gave him butterflies below the belt. "Let me know if the ACA helps your family. I can't wait to see what happens, Candy."
"I will, Dr. Rosedale. Let me know if you need anything,"
she purred, turning to sashay back to the front desk, exaggerating the sway in her curvy hips as her black stilettos kept rhythm on the gray tiled floor. "Damn." He sat at the desk to gather his thoughts and reviewed a chart in preparation for seeing his first case for the day. The voice of a colleague boomed down the hall.
"Can I get some help in room 6?
Compelled to get another view of the state of healthcare in America, Brad darted over to find the doctor prepping a patient for injection. "Hey, Dr. Bob, did you know that 50 million Americans don't have insurance? It's on the news right now. I didn't know it was that bad. Amazing."
"I don't care as long as they don't come into my office," said Bob.
Brad was stunned by the callous rebuttal right in front of his patient.
"Would you ask Candy to get me a syringe with my usual dexamethasone and Marcaine?"
"Yeah, sure," Brad replied. He didn't mind the opportunity to see Candy again. As he marched along the corridor to help his arrogant colleague, their encounter 30 minutes before in the parking garage flashed through his mind. Brad was parked in one of the narrow stalls on the second level and was wheeling his briefcase full of charts toward the elevator when a black BMW careened around the corner, tires screeching, and pulled tightly in next to his car. The driver's door opened with a wham and made a noise of metal on metal. The man who got out was none other than Bob Greedleman, MD, referred to around the office as Dr. Bob. Brad hurried to see what damage had been done.
"Dude, is that your car? Sorry."
Dr. Bob was inspecting the driver's door of his precious 740i.
"I think we're in luck. My door is fine and you're just driving an old Chrysler. No harm done. Damn, these narrow parking spaces though. Let's get upstairs and make some money, buddy."
Brad stepped between the vehicles and inspected the new dent in his passenger's door that contained a scratch down to the primer. For a 10-year-old Chrysler, it had been very clean, but the thoughtless act now made it a beater. "I'll let it go," he said. "But you owe me a steak dinner."
"My treat. How about Harris's Steakhouse after work? I have a loaded schedule and I'll be starving by then."
Despite his arrogance, Dr. Bob was as outgoing as a ray of sunshine on a cloudy day, and it was hard to bear a grudge against him. And he would be good for a $150 meal at the fancy restaurant. "It's a deal. This car can't be worth any more than the cost of running it through a body shop." They went up to the extensive suite of offices on the fourth floor that was the PRA Medical Clinic. Something was broken with healthcare in America, but Brad couldn't single out Dr. Bob as the culprit of anything beyond the dent in his old Chrysler. As an ambitious young doctor upgrading his lifestyle, Bob had flaunted his new Bimmer. But what was this attitude that it's okay to neglect sick or injured people who can't pay? Brad's trauma surgery days when he'd operated on uninsured patients came to mind. But that had led to his bankruptcy with Dr. Black. Dr. Bob would never have signed that contract. Trusting that helping people would guarantee his success had been a fool's game and had led Brad to his downfall. Anyway, achieving material success and helping people were looking like a poor mix. Over the next few weeks, Brad queried his colleagues and read up on the new Affordable Care Act. The business of medicine had been making his colleagues rich. Of the top 1% income bracket, 16% were doctors. And yet tens of millions couldn't afford quality health care. He was astonished to learn that millions of Americans had declared bankruptcy due to their medical bills, including some who had insurance but got hit with massive copays, out-of-pocket expenses, and deductibles. The problem had been solved in the UK with the National Health Service. France and Japan, which had national health insurance, were two of the healthiest nations on earth. The more he researched, the more he was offended that so many working Americans could not afford health care, while their doctors drove around in luxury cars. Brad reflected on his dinner at Harris's Steakhouse, and Dr. Bob's boast that he had just bought a 4-bedroom condo in Lake Tahoe and was planning an office staff ski trip. It would seem that he was being generous and expressing gratitude for the staff, but he'd gone on to say that hosting the staff at his new property was part of a scheme to write the condo purchase off as a business expense.
"To our future success and early wealthy retirement," his colleague had said.
Then they had clinked glasses of Courvoisier. Brad would have been just as happy with a can of Blue Moon. Brad concluded that because doctors didn't care about America's uninsured, they were part of the problem. And after weeks of studying the issue, he could no longer ignore it. He became an activist to support healthcare reform. He discovered organizations of doctors dedicated to healthcare reform. He joined Physicians for a National Health Program, PNHP, which supported single-payer insurance, also called Medicare for All, and had since the 1980s. He liked the idea of single-payer healthcare like France, Canada, Japan, and other countries, but it didn't seem to be politically likely at the time. Then he joined Doctors for the USA, which was committed to supporting the new ACA, which was now the law of the land. The law had been politicized and opposed by Republicans who mocked it as Obamacare. But its supporters rallied by saying, "Obama cares," and the name stuck. Brad participated in phone calls with the D4 USA head office in Washington, D.C., and was asked to become the California State Director for the Young and Developing Organization. Inspired to become a change agent, he teamed up with a like-minded colleague, a crusty, retired thoracic surgeon who also wanted to make a difference. With media support from the DFA National Office, they set up a series of town halls to educate the public. Brad took the time to read the entire 1,100-page ACA and broke it down into a PowerPoint presentation with cartoons and fun questions to captivate the audience. Marketing it with flyers, social media, and relentless word-of-mouth campaigns proved to be a flop. The number of people who came to listen to their talks at the San Francisco Public Library and Marin General Hospital could be counted on one hand, and in rooms that could seat 50 to 200. They were mostly curiosity seekers who had been caught by the colorful signs posted outside. The worst was at Stanford, where less than a dozen students wandered into the lecture hall they had reserved months in advance, then walked out, bored, in the middle of the talk. The final brick to finish the wall of Brad's disillusionment was put in place when Doctors for the USA held a 1 million campaign, a cooperative effort to educate a million Americans about Obamacare. Brad and his colleague kept a careful count on how many people they'd reached by Twitter and email, plus town hall attendees. And after a few months, that number was still in the low hundreds. But one of the directors in another state published an article on the back page of a newspaper and counted all 150,000 subscribers as now educated about Obamacare. Other state directors followed similarly. And D4 USA soon announced their campaign was a success, with a million Americans having been educated. Brad was infuriated after scanning the final 1 million campaign report and seeing all of the states listed with their numbers in the tens and hundreds of thousands, except California, bottom listed at 850. "Robert, what do you think here?" Brad asked over the phone. He knew the retired doc would have seen the report and he expected him to commiserate.
"Somebody should turn those bastards in," came the reply. "We worked our asses off and all they did was take out newspaper ads. It's an insult. Let's go to the White House and tell Obama."
President Obama may care about Americans' health, but Brad doubted he would care about a grassroots organization pretending to educate people about the 1,100-page ACA document.
"I am glad you're fired up, too. I didn't want to read this wrong," said Brad. "Let's do lunch and talk more about it."
"Yeah, next week after I cool down. This week I'm going to get my golf game going again and get back to my city council meetings. This has been a waste of 6 months of my retirement, goddammit. I need to get my mind off these idiots. Brad concluded that the healthcare reformers were as corrupt as the broken system they were trying to fix. Frustrated by public apathy, disenchanted by his greedy colleagues, and disillusioned by the crooked reformers, he came to believe that helping others was best done through individual action and choice. Other ways to help always came along, but his ability to make a difference, even as an individual, was going to be severely tested.